In the name of the Father, and of the Son,
and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let all who would know the risen Christ gather now for worship.
For Christ is, and we're all sent to come, a sign of our salvation.
God has defeated death and the grave once and for all.
And in Christ we are called to be the church, a symbol of God's love.
Christ, who ascends to the heaven, will surely return the claim, the church.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Let us remain standing. Our first hymn is number 370, Rejoice, O Lord, Glory is King.
First of all, the inserts is in your bulletin. Please fill those out. If you have any hymns in the box, it's down front on the front row, to please put that in the box. Next Sunday after church, I will be leaving for vacation, and Reverend Ryan Breakmeyer will be on call during that week. Today, we, of course, have both his kids and youth fellowship at 3. The youth group is going mini golfing, and his kids has the outdoor games here at the church. Please make note of the dates for Vacation Bible School and Strengthen the Church, and anyone wanting to sign up for altar flowers. Do we have anything else, announcements today? Okay.
Cemetery committee meeting after church in the library.
Okay.
And board will be in the conference room.
Okay, board in the conference room. Jan?
Consistory packets are ready. Please pick them up after church.
Okay. Turning our attention into our prayer list. Patsy's mother, she fell this week and broke her hip, and we'll keep her in our prayers. Her name is Estelle Philippi. Is there anyone else to lift up in prayer today? Yes, Pat?
Daryl Bradshaw.
Daryl Bradshaw? Then let us go to God
in prayer. Almighty God, as we come into your house today, we thank you so much for your presence. As we worship you, we ask that you would send your Holy Spirit upon us. on this Ascension Sunday, we are thankful for the fact that Christ ascended and returned into his kingdom. And we praise you for the hope and the glory that one day we will ascend into his kingdom as well. We thank you, O God, for the fact that you are with us here and now, that you send that Spirit to guide us, that you illuminate the paths that you would have us to walk. O God, we thank you for your presence here and now. We ask that you would be with us as we worship, that you would guide us with your Spirit, that we might hear the words of the Lord, that they might affect us, that they might change us, that they might help us to grow. Too often, O God, we come into this house so that we don't change, when in fact we need to be changing. We need to grow so that we will experience more closeness with you, O God. Help us to continue to follow your plans for us. We thank you so much for the fellowship that we experience in this congregation, the fact that you are with us here and now. Help continue to guide us, O God, that we might experience you in the uptimes and the downs. Help us to wrestle with you, with our struggles, and bring our cares and concerns and leave them at your altar. And now, O God, we pray as Christ taught us to pray, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
This time, like for the children to come forward.
Like, I don't want to play with you.
And I'm stupid.
Yeah. And don't be stupid. That's not nice either, is it? So you see, all this in there is things that we do that's not very nice. So what happens in our water? It went blue. It's kind of blue. It's not pretty and clear. You can't see through it. Well, so Jesus comes into our hearts. It's not going to turn purple. It's going to be something else.
Yellow.
No, it's not going to be yellow.
There's yellow on top.
That's right, little babe. Can you see that? What did it do? Did it separate?
There is bubbles.
But did it separate us from the blue part?
No.
Yes. See that line? It's yellow on top and blue on the bottom, right? So that's what it means.
And then yellow on the top.
Yeah. Well, no, it's clear. So it separates the bad from the good. So when Jesus comes into our hearts, that means we're supposed to be different. People are supposed to look at us different. So what if you had a friend, let's say his name was Bubba, and Bubba was always mean to you. Like, he would say, you're not going to be on my team. Or he would say, why do you wear your hair like that? But anytime Bubba was mean to you, you stayed nice. And other people would look at you and like, why? Every time he's mean to you, are you nice? That's being set apart. That's not letting him get to you. That's using God in your heart, and that's what we want to do. So once you have Jesus in your heart, you are supposed to be set apart. And people's going to want to know what you have. And what do you have? You have Jesus in your heart. So we all want to be set apart. So you can come up here and get you a snorker.
Sisters who are God's people, join with me now in praying our prayer of confession. Oh God, too often
we have stood around waiting for your return. When we have been involved or are being there finding answers to the problems that surround us. Too often we have proclaimed our helplessness rather than truly praying and seeking your guidance.
Hear the good news of Jesus Christ, promised in the gospel to all who repent and believe. As I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in death of the wicked, but the wicked turn from their ways and live. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen.
Thank you.
bring his son to Jesus.
Scripture text today comes from the book of Acts, the first chapter, the 1st through the 14th verses. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote all about that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit, the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you've heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the dates or the times the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria and the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up unto the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from a hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. Sanctify us through your words are truth, O Lord. Let us now join together confessing our faith using the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried, he descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and is sitting on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
As our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ has blessed us, let us return a portion of those blessings to Almighty God. As we set foot in your house, we come bearing gifts, but with these gifts in mind, we also are reminded of the fact that you first blessed us. And as we lay these gifts upon your altar, we ask that you would use these gifts, that you would multiply them for the upbuilding of this church and for your kingdom upon this earth. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Reading from St. John's Gospel, the 1st through the 11th verses. After Jesus said this, he looked towards heaven and prayed, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and that Jesus Christ, whom you have sent, I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. I have revealed you, those who gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. And the glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name that you gave me, so that while they may be one, as we are one." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Our New Testament lesson today comes from the book of Acts. And this is the first chapter of Acts, and it gives you the intro to the book. Because Luke and Acts are written by the same person that we presume is Luke, in fact. And it starts with this intro in my former book, Theophilus. For countless ages, people have questioned, who is Theophilus? The name in the Greek, Theo means God, and Philios is a type of love. And so the name literally means lover of God, or someone who loves God. And so it's wondered, in fact, is this written to a person who had that name, or is it written to people like ourselves, who love God? And I think that we don't need to spend too much time on that particular tangent, but I always like to ask questions when I'm reading these things in the Bible. Who was the original audience? What did it say to them? And what is it saying to us today? But it is a continuation of Luke's gospel, in which he is talking about the ending of Christ's earthly time, where it says that they go out and watch him ascend, and they are looking to the sky when this angelic being comes to them. And I've been like that before. You know, sometimes I have to study at something, and I look at it a lot in hope that a solution will come. And I feel that the disciples were kind of the same way. Jesus said to them, go back to Jerusalem. He gave them pretty clear instructions that they were not to leave Jerusalem until the gift of the Father came, and the gift of the Father is the Holy Spirit. Today we are celebrating Ascension Sunday. Next week will be Pentecost, which is the coming of the Holy Spirit. If you take a moment to look at the window that's on this side of the church, that is the representation of the Ascension. That is the scripture that we are talking about today. And we have this moment where then the disciples are staring off, wondering what will happen. And the men dressed in white tell them, the same Jesus who was taken to you will return. So go back to Jerusalem and go about your business. Something else that I noticed upon this reading and preparing for today's sermon that had never really struck me before, the place where they're at, it said, was a Sabbath's day walk from the city. And I found that that was a very interesting thing, and that's a way of measuring distance, because on the Sabbath, you weren't supposed to do walking and as a journey. You did not travel, but you were allowed to walk small distances because you had to do such thing. And so this was a much closer distance. It is not a true day's walk, but a Sabbath day's walk where they were at. And so they go upstairs and are all together. And this is where our text leads off. And it's an intro a little bit into next week's text with the Pentecost and the coming of the Holy Spirit. But this pairs today with John's gospel, where Jesus is praying for his disciples. And he continues to give this wonderful prayer for the Spirit to come upon them. Because today, this Sunday, is almost a waiting time, a expecting time, a time that something better is yet to come. But Jesus continues to point to the Father and says, all that I have is His. And that nothing in the world is worth hanging on to. You know, I think at times I'm as guilty as the next person, we tend to gravitate towards things. We want to hold on to our stuff. In fact, I think one of the funniest stories that I ever heard was, you know, this rich fellow, and he had so much money, he kept it in cash, and his one desire when he passed on was to be buried with all of that money. And so he died. And one of his friends asked the widow, well, did you follow his instructions? Surely you didn't bury him with his money. And this widow said, well, that's what he wanted. I didn't want to disappoint his last instruction, but I also hated to put all that cash in there with him, so I just wrote a check and put it in his pocket. But you can't take it with you. And it's important that what we are depending on are the things that last, the spiritual things. And that's what Jesus is praying for his disciples. And I feel like if Jesus were among us today, he would be praying for us as the church, that we worry less about ourselves and more about the rest of the world, that we be more outward looking. You know, that's, I think, the struggle with humanity is to push back. Sometimes Christianity, if we are looking at it in its purest form, it really goes against common sense and reason. It's a purer way in which we are looking after other people, people who are not always going to treat us the right way. And that's why it's important to live in the Spirit. And Jesus, in this moment, is acknowledging that he is returning to his Father in heaven. But he is sending the greatest gift that we can have, which is the Spirit, which is God with us. The Scriptures talk so much about love. You know, this intro to Acts is just one of the many places that love is mentioned. But there's something powerful whenever it is talking about God constantly being with us, God constantly being there for us in the good times, in the bad times, and in the struggles. You know, I try to be thankful when things are going well. Because I found it's sometimes harder to pray and to take time when things are going well. And in fact, I don't want things to go badly, so it becomes easier to pray. But how often when things are going well and falling into place, do we truly thank God? Do we thank God for His bounty? Or do we tend to think that it's all by our own efforts at that point in time? I always try when I take up the offering to have some sort of part of the prayer that acknowledges that the gifts that we are returning to God are gifts that He had already given to us, that these blessings come from the hands of the Almighty. Because where would we be without the gifts and abilities that is bestowed by the hands of Almighty God? There are times for action, and then there's times for waiting. You know, I'm a person who does not like to make hasty decisions. If there's a decision that can take some time to think it through, to look at all of the angles, that should happen. But then there's times when one must make a quick decision. And this time, we're not just to be watching the sky. It's not a time of idleness, but a time of reflection, a time of thinking, a time of making our next move count. Because the Holy Spirit will come upon us, and that will change us as His people. You know, often, you know, we get in silly things at times, I think, with church. You know, the way you like things has a lot to do with the way one grew up and one experienced things. And, you know, there are countless jokes about the denominations and things of that nature. But so many of these things has to do with our own preferences and less about what the Scriptures say. But I think an important question is to ask, what kind of church are we wanting to be? Because there's a lot of right ways of doing things, and there are a lot of things that are not necessarily wrong and not necessarily right, and we have to ask, what kind of church are we trying to be? And maybe as individuals, we need to ask, what kind of Christian are we trying to be? Because it's acceptable if we just want to be a Christian when we feel like it. But is that really what God is calling us to do? Is God calling us to just passively be a part of His church? Or is He calling us into action? Are we letting that Spirit truly guide us as it should? And so maybe in this waiting time, where we're waiting for the Spirit of God to descend, we need to stop and think and see what is the best option for us. What is our next move? How will God lead us? Because I'm convinced that God has great things in store for us. Because Jesus, in this prayer, He first prays to be glorified. But it is not for His own glory, it is for the glory of Almighty God. And then He translates into praying for His disciples. And what we are doing here, it is not to make ourselves look good. It is to praise Almighty God. It is to glorify His presence. For He is the one who's given us His Son and given us eternal life. And Jesus will guide us in the darkness and in the struggles and in the hard times and will be with us. But what we do here, we represent God, and we represent Christ. The question is, are we a good representative, or are we a bad representative? How are we showing the path to God for other people? Maybe it's okay for a while to watch the sky, but we can't stand there forever because Christ is coming and His Spirit is with us now, dwelling in our hearts and in our minds. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for these words of Scripture, for the comfort they bring to us and the fact they challenge us. Help us to be better versions of ourselves. Help us that we might serve you as best as we're able. We thank you for your presence among us, that we might serve you as best as we're able. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand for our final hymn, number 426, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds.
Spirit, rest and abide with each of you both now and forevermore. Amen.